listening to the Fit Mind, Fit Body podcast, where we explore the connection between a fit body and positive mental health. And our big mission? It's to help 10,000 runners to develop fitter minds in the next 2 years. I'm your host, Michelle Frost. Let's get moving. Welcome to this episode of the Fit Mind, Fit Body podcast. Today we talk to Andrew Woodford, and he shares how running has helped him find resilience to manage all of those ups and downs that life throws at us. Enjoy. Today on Fit Mind, Fit Body, I am very excited to introduce you all to Andrew Woodford. Hello, Andrew.
Hello, Michelle.
Welcome to the podcast. I'm glad that you agreed to be grilled by me.
I'm excited, actually. I'm looking forward to it. I have been following him, and I thought, you know, it'd be nice to come on one of these and, I guess, share my journey, share my story. And I'm very grateful that you invited me, so thank you.
I'm really excited to learn about it, actually. I love learning. You know, I don't know your story, so I'm really looking forward to learning about it. So digging in is going to be fun for me too. So let's start at the very start. Andrew, where did you grow up?
Oh, I grew up in the eastern suburbs of Melbourne.
Oh, there you go. And when you were at school, was running a thing? And whereabouts, because I'm nosy, whereabouts in the eastern suburbs? What eastern suburb were you growing up in?
So I grew up in the suburb of Mitcham, which is in between Nutterwadding and Ringwood.
Yep.
So sort of the, just the eastern suburbs. Yeah. Middle class, I guess, if you wanted to put it into some sort of class. Went to public school.
Yeah.
Do remember doing athletics at school. Hated it.
Funny. Yeah, I remember that. So when you were at school, you weren't particularly sporty. It wasn't like, oh, gosh, I really need to, this is a thing that I enjoy doing.
No, I was into, well, I played AFL for the local footy club.
Yeah.
And I was also—I've always been a bit of a bike rider. You know, when you're a kid, back then we're talking the 70s. So yeah. I'm an old bugger. So, you know, we went everywhere on our bikes. You know, that was the motor transport. You know, a lot of freedom. You know, there's no way you do what we used to do as kids. You know, I was gone by the time, you know, 13 or 14, and it's riding everywhere.
Wow!
So I was always riding, and. Got into competitive bike riding there for a little while, couple of years, so that was fun.
Wow, yeah. And so how old were you then?
It would have been 15, 16.
Oh, yeah.
And I also then left home when I was 16.
Yeah.
Moved interstate, joined the Air Force.
Wow. Oh, before you skip up to that, what kind of bike riding? Was it like road?
Road riding. Yeah. Yep.
Mm-hmm. All right, so then you joined the Air Force when you were 16.
Yep, left home.
How is that?
Daunting, and it's pretty exciting. But I guess I knew I needed to spread my wings. Well, I didn't know, but my mum knew. So I needed adventure, and I needed to. And I was pursuing a trade. You know, I was pursuing a qualification, and represented the Air Force in cycling. So we had inter-service sports in between. You know, so you got selected on doing local races to represent the apprentice inter-service sports. So where we had competition between the Army and the Navy. So, yeah, I got to represent that. It was pretty cool. Did some major road racing events. So,
And that was all in Australia? Like you did all that in Australia?
Yeah, in Australia.
So where did you first go? Where do you go to? Where did you do your training?
When you were 16? Wagga. I was in Wagga. Wagga.
Oh, yeah.
Wagga, Wagga, New South Wales. So, yeah.
And what trade did you do?
I became what's called a motor transport fitter, so basically motor mechanic.
Oh, yeah. And how long did you stay in?
When you're 16, you have to sign for 9.
Wow.
So.
That must seem like ages when you're 16.
Oh, it did actually. Absolutely. I remember now how long that seemed like it was.
Wow.
And in Wagga for a couple of years. I was in Wagga for a couple of years and then you got posted out. So you did your training, qualified. Yep. So they condense everything that a normal person would do outside in 4 years into 2.5 with a high pass mark. You have to get, you've only allowed 3 fails. If you fail 3 times, you're out.
That's a lot of pressure.
Yeah, a bit of pressure. Mm-hmm. And then we, yeah, we got posted out to an operational base and just began our working life. But, yeah, I knew probably halfway through that I was not going to stay in any longer than my allocated time.
Yeah.
And they're very clever. So it's 4 years training, so you're a pay for plus one but less than 10, so you don't get long service. So if you want that, you've got to sign on for another 6.
No.
Yeah, so.
Some nasty person sitting at a desk somewhere in Canberra. Came up with that.
Absolutely.
And so, you did skip out, you did leave after 9 years, that's what you did?
Yeah. I was 25 and, you know, I was done. And, you know, I wanted to represent my country. I'm proud of it. I'm a proud Australian. So we did my bit. Yeah. But I was over the whole, you know, the auxiliary, you know, I used to have to do a lot of other duties as well. So so things like that were a bit annoying. And I had, you know, a bit of a life then. So, yeah. So then I elected to get out in Hobart because of I met my first wife in Victoria.
Yeah.
So the idea was to move. So I ended up in Tassie. So moved here 30 years ago and the Air Force paid for the move.
And you're still here.
I'm still here.
That's very cool.
I'll get back to Melbourne, yeah.
It's nice to visit. I do like visiting Melbourne. I was born there, although I didn't grow up there. That was where I was born. Extended family is from there.
Yeah,
so I do like
too big, too much traffic, too big now.
Yeah, so much traffic. It's crazy, actually.
And I think we dodged a really, really good bullet from not being there for the last couple of years. So.
Oh, totally, yeah, being locked down so much. Anyway, my daughter was locked down. She didn't enjoy it. She came home whenever she could.
All my family's over there, so.
So we got to, you and I got to see it viscerally what it was like for our family, even if we didn't have to do it, which was.
Exactly right. Yeah. So there you go. That's the beginnings.
Did you, what was your favourite thing about being, was the Air Force, did you say?
Yeah.
So what was your favourite thing about that time? It was 9 years.
The favourite thing, I would say it set me up for life. Mm-hmm. The discipline that is put, you know, ingrained into you, mm-hmm. And there are a lot of other qualities. I mean, they took, there was 10,000 applicants for my year, and from that they selected 160. And they did that through 3 days worth of medical tests, psychological tests, mm-hmm. physical tests, et cetera, all around the country. So they had a pretty amazing psychological team because they they only selected 160. And out of that 160, you're looking at guys that get on, you know, even though we all got together, did our thing, and then, you know, haven't seen each other. We're just getting together for a big reunion. It's our 40th anniversary, 40th reunion this year.
Wow.
And you can pick up exactly where you left off. So they did a really good job of selecting people based on their psychological assessments. But I guess what it gave us was some amazing life qualities, which is discipline as one.
Yeah. And do you find, like, obviously you're on here because you like to run. Did you find that from the outside, those of us who haven't been in the forces, imagine that there is quite a lot of physical activity going on, even if you know you're training to be a particular trade, but there's still that degree, as you said, with the discipline that is the physical side. So where you have to do a lot of stuff to stay fit in some way, at least that's what we imagine it's like.
Yeah, it is. No, there's heaps of physical stuff. So every week we would do, you know, what's called PT, I suppose, physical training. And that was, you know, we used to do airfield runs, which was really funny because we used to have to run around the airfield, which is 5Ks, right?
Oh, wow.
Back then I used to think that was so far. It's now 5Ks is a warm-up, so.
You won't even go out.
Pretty much, no, I do. But it's like, you know, I think back to those days thinking, oh, man, running around that goddamn road around the airfield in bloody 40-degree heat because water's so hot.
Yeah.
Or freezing cold is either or.
Yeah.
But we used to do runs in columns, which I'd hated. No one likes running in columns because you have to run at a very slow pace, which is difficult.
So columns, is that like people next to you and behind you and in front of you?
Yeah. Yeah.
How many next? Sorry, you were going to.
So it was three columns, yep. And probably, I don't know, six or seven to a row, so 18 oh, 18 wow. people there. And we have to run with packs.
Yeah. Wow. And that was a kind of regular thing to yep. keep you all. Did you do, apart, I suppose you did do stuff outside of that because you did the cycling.
Yeah. And I roller skated when I was a blogger. I was big into roller skating back then.
Roller skating.
Yeah, it was a big thing. So I would probably, when we're allowed off base, we were allowed off base for the first 6 months because the first year was all about just being in the forces.
Yeah, just
and,
learning.
And doing like, you know, basic training and things like that. So, you know, we had to, you know, we were taught how to shoot, all that sort of yeah. stuff. So that was funny. It's a really famous photo of my flight. So there's 14 in flight seven. You know, there we are with AKs and SLRs. We're all laughing now. Imagine letting all these bunch of 16-year-olds loose with SLRs.
No, that's crazy.
What do you think they're going? Oh, my God. You know, we're taught how to shoot for a kilometre, things like that. So
wow.
It's pretty amazing. But, yeah, back then I was into roller skating because I used to do a lot of roller skating back in Melbourne. So I found a local rink, which I went and visited a year ago to see if it's still there. And, yeah, I was speed skating, roller hockey, general skating. I was the under-17 speed skating champion in 1981, I think, or two.
Wow, that is very cool. Because I grew up on King Island. There was not a skating rink, but I did have skates and there was cement out the front of my place. And whenever we went to Melbourne, would take my skates and go to the skating rink. And I can remember seeing the speed skaters and stuff and it was like, wow, they're so fast. And, like, you try, think you were going fast, but, like, they'd be lapping
oh, yeah.
a lot.
It's just so cool. A lot of fun.
That is very cool. And so I remember the, was it roller disco thing? That used yep. to be, for me, I could just remember thinking that was just amazing, like going at nighttime and having yep. music and all of that. It was like a whole another world, I suppose.
That was a Saturday night at Wagga Rollerama. Saturday
oh, there
night.
You go.
Yeah, it was so funny. It's funny because now, you know how you hear all the songs
yeah.
from the years.
Yeah.
you they bring you right back.
Yeah, it's like that emotion that was attached yeah. to that time
yeah.
for you.
Yeah.
It's quite amazing. Incredible. So do you skate now? Just out of interest?
No, I haven't done that for a long time, except when I take the girls ice skating at the local ice skating rink, which is now just closed. So Tassie's just lost its only ice skating rink.
I did hear that on the radio the other day. I didn't even know we had an ice skating rink, which is a terrible thing to say, but yeah. I thought that's a bit sad. Oh, there you go. There's a business opportunity for somebody. Open up an ice skating rink.
A lot of sad people around because they, there's no ice dancing or ice hockey. There's a bit of an ice hockey fine down here. So
really, oh wow, that's not good. Oh no. Well, we can't do anything about it right now. So you ended up in Tasmania in Hobart.
Yep.
What did you do?
What did I do?
What did you do?
So is in employment or?
Yeah, like what did you do? Did you go, I suppose you were a mechanic, you were a trained mechanic from the Air Force?
No, actually, well, when I got out, I made a couple of decisions. One, I was never going back on the tools.
Okay.
I wanted to deal with people, and that's been my thing for a long, long time. And I wanted to be in a position where I could dictate my own terms in regards to what I could earn from a from a working point of view.
Yeah.
So for the first year here, I brought down with me when I moved from Victoria, I brought down a software package that was designed for computers to go into the automotive industry. So I wanted to still stay within the automotive industry because I knew it, but come from a different viewpoint of efficiency and, you know, organisation and things like that, because that's, you know, come from the Air Force. Everything's very organised, very squared away. But I was a little bit early. Market wasn't ready for it. So I spent about 8 or 9 months to work out, not making any money here. This is not working. Tassie workshops weren't interested in computerising at the time. So some had, but.
What year were we talking about?
90.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. 1990.
Yeah, a bit early. Anyway. Thinking about me running around as a digital coach in 2012, 2013. like trying to get Tasmanian businesses to go online. Yeah. I can imagine, you know, 10 years earlier or whatever that was, sort of, yeah, 12 years earlier, you know, the idea of anything kind of too techie takes a little while to turn this Titanic. And so then you moved from that, or you went sideways? What did you do?
Oh, no, I actually thought about getting into real estate. So I applied for a real estate role and didn't get it. I was second choice. But he said, look, we put you on, but you don't know anybody. Because I didn't, you know, I didn't really have a upbringing here, or, and I think that circle really works in that. So I applied for another role with a company, a local company, family-owned company, and interviewed well but got turned down. That's all right. It happens. I was a bit naive. It's like I've only ever had three job interviews my whole life. So this was the third one. About 2 weeks later, they rang back and said,
actually,
can you come back over? We'd like to have another chat. So I came back over, and turns out the guy they selected turned it down. Bummer for him, great for me.
So then what happened? What kind of business, what sort of business was that?
So supplying specialised chemicals into the automotive industry.
Oh, yeah. So
and it was completely completely commission only. It's basically entrepreneurial, it's professional sales,
Mm-hmm.
And, yeah, it was really, really green, really out of my depth. So I had to sink or swim or learn to survive, so. And you had to, because it was commission only back then. Had to provide, you know, we had to pay our own tax, we had to provide a car, so I had to go into debt. Wow. Yeah, you get the job, but you need to go and buy a car 6 years later.
Oh, wow. So how did that go? You got through that, or?
Yeah, got through that. Mm-hmm. And, so became quite, you know, successful at it. Got promoted up to looking after new car dealerships, which is a different world altogether. And, you know, those guys operate at a different level, but I can talk to them at their level. You know, we talked a bit about personal development before. I had to, you know, I learned, you know, I did some personal development and I learned how those businesses operate. So I can deal with some of those and won a few awards along the way. A lot, like seven state awards, top awards. So
that's amazing. Yeah. And so what do you do now? Like this,
I'm still actually working for that company, as well as running an online wellness business. So
look at you. So that was a family company, you said. So sure is. So you're kind of part of the family now, I reckon.
Pretty well. And some of my clients have been dealing with for nearly 28, 29 years. I've been dealing mostly, some of the dealerships I've been dealing with for 25. So I'm very much part of their furniture. So it's good when you can buy a car because they look after you.
They know who you are.
I guess I've earned the respect, earned the trust, which is important in, you know, human relations and business relationships. And my philosophy has always been to help somebody else get something.
Yeah.
And if that happens, then I get something. So, and it has to be a win both ways.
That sales is really about being a good people person and being able to do just what you said, help both sides of the equation have a win.
Yeah, exactly, because it's got to be mutually beneficial. So that's been my philosophy, and I guess that's why that's endeared me to some people for so long. And I guess it's always been challenging. It's an extremely fast-moving industry, particularly in the last 10 years. A lot of people don't realise how technical motor vehicles have got.
Mm.
Most of them have got somewhere between 30 to 40 modules, which is the little computers that control lots of different operations within a car. And within those modules there's probably, I don't know, 15, 18 semiconductors, which is the big problem for getting new cars.
Well, my husband likes to fix our cars, so we have to keep buying older ones because the newer models are not something that he can fix, is what he was telling me the other day when I was saying I want a new car. He was saying, no, I don't think I could fix it if you got like a car that was too new. So anyway, that's where we're stuck in our world. And you've also got an online health and wellness business?
Yeah.
You were saying? How long ago did you start that up?
A couple of years ago.
Mm-hmm.
Came across and this put a tie into my longer story, but it came across a product that's unique. So the interesting, my experience for the last 30 years has been supplying a unique product or new chemicals mm-hmm. into the automotive industry. So mm-hmm. it's aligned with that, but it also from a health and wellness perspective because of my longer term story, which you'll find out in about in a minute. So mm-hmm. I came across this product that's unique, mm-hmm. but it's natural, and basically people sleep better, feel better, yep. have more energy. And it's been around for about 20 years, but only in Australia for about the last four. So no one knows anything about it. So,
and so do you have like a website that you?
Yep.
Yep. So if you want, we can put that in the show notes as well, so people can go and check it out.
Okay. Cool.
Yeah. I don't know if there's anything else you want to talk to them about it.
Peer reviewed. So it's been published. So there's been 31 independent studies, 27 are published on PubMed. So I've started to learn a little bit about the downfalls of Google. So Google has not some good things about it because people go to Google and make decisions based on what they read there, which unfortunately, if someone's paid, as you would know from a marketing background, a digital marketing background, if you're paid to have your brief, your mm-hmm. topic at the top, whether it be negative or positive, mm-hmm. people read that and then they make a decision that they probably shouldn't make on someone else's opinion, not the facts.
Yeah.
I'm a big fact checker, have been for a long time.
Yeah. Especially in this day and age, hasn't that been important in the last, you know, through Trump and then in COVID?
Yeah.
Like fact checking has been quite a thing now, I think.
Yeah. So the benefit of this particular product is A, is unique, B, it's mm-hmm. independently tested, but it helps particularly for athletes, helps recovery.
Oh,
helps recovery and speeds up recovery.
Yeah.
So well, that's my, and I proved that to myself. So
yeah. Awesome. Well, we can get other people to click on the link and go and have a little look and look at that peer-reviewed research that you're talking about as well, so that they can make informed decisions about stuff.
Right. That's all I'm about. I'm not there to, it's not something that I sell. It's more about empowering people with knowledge to make an educated decision. That's the way I look at it.
Yeah. That's kind of how I feel about this podcast in a way, like wanting to get more people to understand that running is not just good for your physical body, but it's really good for your mental health as well. And hopefully by sharing lots of people's stories, that'll come across, because otherwise it's not, you know, we think it's common knowledge because we're runners, many of us anyway, but it's actually not necessarily. Anyway, there you go. Little public service health announcement there. Now you alluded then to why you even went looking for, you know, something. So tell us a little bit about that. Like you said, you would share. Why did you start running? How did you start?
That's
running?
A great
How
question.
How did it even get into your life beyond?
That's a fabulous question.
And then when did you start running?
Okay, so my story gets really interesting now. So. Let's quickly backtrack. So I had a first wife.
Yep.
She decided she didn't want to be married anymore.
I had and a first husband.
So I didn't know anything about that apart from the fact that, you know, we're going to go our separate ways. Okay.
Oh.
Move on. Eventually met, well, I actually knew the lady that I'm married to now. I had known mm-hmm. for a long time. So we were remarried in 2005 and we restarted another family. So I've got four children, two boys to my first wife and two girls to my second.
Mm-hmm.
So Sienna was born in 2005 and Alira was born in 2009.
Mm-hmm.
In 2010, on the 28th of October, our family life changed forever.
Mm-hmm.
My wife, who was stationed in a vehicle, was hit from behind and she had her neck turned to her left and she was turned to her father and she got severe whiplash.
No, ouch.
So that began a journey that's still going today 12 years later. So mm-hmm. she's now in a wheelchair.
Mm-hmm.
And disabled. So back then, she struggled with neck pain, shoulder pain, migraines, mm-hmm. all sorts of, you know, anxiety.
Yeah.
We began the journey of various different physios, and that turned into some nerve blocks with some mm-hmm. specialized people. That turned, she'd given up work. So she hasn't worked since then.
Mm-hmm.
So we had an 18-month-old and a 6-year-old.
That's challenging.
I've done everything since, pretty much. Mm-hmm. So I do all the cooking. I do all the cooking. Don't do the cleaning now. But all the cleaning, running around, you know, taking care of her, working full time. So 2013, I'd put on a bit of weight, and I had the absolute shit scared out of me by my doctor who I'd been seeing forever. So once again, getting back to relationships, we had a personal relationship. So she could afford to be blunt. She said, you're 48, you're heading down the wrong road. Wow. You know, I was 105 kilos. I was 116 centimetres around the chest, 113 centimetres around the waist. Like, I was stressed out.
Did you say how tall are you?
Sorry?
How tall are you?
180. So I had the wrong BMI, put it that way. Yeah, so she encouraged me to make some changes. So
not so much looking after yourself, I guess. That's probably how
you
put it.
Yeah, pretty much. So in 2013, my neighbour across the road who joined a gym was encouraging me, no, you need to come to the gym, you need to come to the gym, you're really cool, blah, blah, blah. So I thought in January 2013 I need to make some changes, otherwise I'm not going to be around, you know, I'm a heart attack waiting to happen down the road.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
especially with the role as well that I worked with, you know, there's a lot of stress and there's a lot of pressure. So in 2013 January, I joined the gym and really loved it. Had a ball. It was a bit of, it was like group PT.
Yeah.
A lot of fun. You know, we did boxing. I'd never done that before. So I got quite good at that. So that was fun. But they decided as a team to enter the Sydney Casino and the 7K as a team. So I put my hand, oh, yeah, we'll do that because I like that. I like community, you know, being with people, groups of people doing stuff. So I did some bit of running, had a treadmill. Started doing some practice on the treadmill and, oh, man, I look at some of the posts back then. It's like, oh, my God. I was so pumped because I managed to get to this pace and all this. Which is great because it's just goes to show how far that we come in our running journey. You know, when we all start off, it's like everything else in life. We start the same. Absolutely. At the beginning, you know, your running journey is at the beginning. You've got to learn like any other skill. You've got to learn how to do it and to persist with it and fail and play, you know. A few successes, fail a bit more, you know. So, yeah, so we did the Sydney Casino and I ran that. That was my first fun run, 2013.
What month was that? What month did they run it? In May. So it was only sort of 5 months after you'd gone to the gym. You were running a 7K, I suppose?
Yeah, it was a 7, yeah. And I think I did it in, I can't remember what it was. I was pretty pumped because I remember doing, I ended up doing the event better than I had done. So I've been running on the treadmill, you see.
Yeah.
And I think I thought, oh, wow, if I get down there in 45 minutes, I'll be happy. You know, and I think I did 39 or something. I was so pumped.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
So the gym work must have also really helped with losing the weight and feeling stronger and all of that.
Help my cardio.
Especially over 5 months to be able to do a 7K. And that's awesome. Like if you think about it, to go from where you were in that quite a short period of time, really. I was just thinking.
Yeah, so plus you feel good about it. So then the natural progression from that is to obviously work up to a 10.
Like what's next?
I think what's next? So I think I don't think I did Lonnie that year. Maybe I did. No, I don't think I did. I didn't do Lonnie. I think the first 10 was I walked Point to Pinnacle that year. Never do that again walking. That's so hard.
I always walk the last bit of that one. Like when I get to a stage where my running seems to be no faster than a walking pace, and I can actually breathe if I walk.
I think my first 10 was a bridge run.
Okay. Yeah.
Or Canberra, one of those two. I don't know which one it was.
So
in 2014.
The continuing to run after that initial thing, was it, can you remember if it was crossing the line or that? You know, these new friends of yours from perhaps the gym or from the running, they're like, oh, we're all signing up for something, and you kind of all join it together, or were you sort of just looking for that finish line fever? I don't know what we call it. Because a few people have said recently about, yeah, I just wanted to do it again. Like I crossed that finish line and I just felt so great. I just wanted to do that again.
I think it was that actually. It's the achievement of crossing the line and being, you've done something.
Yeah.
You know, as we all know, when you cross that finish line, it's the most rewarding and, you know, that feeling you get, particularly like something like Point to Pinnacle. When you cross that finish line, it's like, oh God, I'm so stuffed. But this was, you know, the high is amazing. Runner's high, I suppose. We all know what it's like.
Yeah, it's great.
and I guess it was part of the team. You know, we had a great team and probably a little bit of healthy competition. You know, there's a few people there who were way younger than me that just, you know, I was just amazed. I thought, oh, wow. You know, that was inspiring for me.
Yeah.
You know, inspiring to do better.
So you just kept going. Like we're talking about 2013.
Yep.
After that, you've not really stopped running, I assume, or have you? Or how does
no, I haven't stopped. Look? Mm-hmm. No, I haven't stopped. So this will be my ninth year of running. So I did the natural progression. Do the 7, do the 10. Okay, it's only a half. It's not that far. Then do a mara. Yeah. You know, that's not that far. Then do an ultra. So, so over the next few years, it was I remember doing Bridge Run, Lonnie Run, you know, Lonnie 10. I did all the major ones.
Yeah.
Did I think I ran point in 20, all the be over there on the wall. all my ribbons are there somewhere. Yeah, I did the point, I think it was 2014 or 15 was the first one.
Yeah.
But I remember doing the Bridge Run in 2016 and, you know, sometimes your mind is better than the body.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, if you look at across the finish line in 2016, I stumbled across the line because I was nearly passing out because I'd gone so hard, particularly in the last couple of Ks.
Wow.
Once again, stupid stuff because the mind, you can do it, you can do it. But the body really wasn't, you know, I really pushed myself. And if you look at it, I was wobbly coming across the finish line because I was probably about to pass out.
So why do you think you pushed yourself then? Like, and you said it's time. Mind. Is it so you chase times? Is that what you find now? Is that one of the things that inspires you now for you to keep?
It was. And probably to, bit of healthy competition with some other people.
Mm-hmm.
But, I mean, I was still heavy, still pretty heavy back then. I wasn't heavier.
Yeah.
I'd lost some weight, but I still wasn't, you know, I've always not necessarily struggled with weight, but I'm just a bigger fella. So, anyway, so then we went on, took the family, went overseas for 6 weeks, went to America.
Uh-huh.
And when we came back, I decided then that I needed to get a bit smarter about running because I knew that the Bridge Run wasn't a really good run. It was a silly thing to do, and I reflected on that by going, you know what, I need to do this better. So
what did you do? So, what does better look like for you, Andrew?
Well, I had a chat with a friend of mine who's sort of actually, I started running, I was doing long distance running out of the winter, and a friend from the gym, ex-neighbour, took me under, she's a runner, probably should get on the podcast actually, I shouldn't be on that, put her up for this.
Love recommendations.
So she took me kind of under a wing and started just teaching me a bit about running. Actually, she'd been running for ages. So she's a long-term runner. She took me under a wing and she caught up with me one day and said, oh, can I run with you? I said, yeah. And so kind of subtly she was just educating me with running and bits of stuff. And then we end up doing a longer distances. And then she said to me in September, October, you know, you're really deep into a marathon program. No.
Oh, that's crazy.
So
you kind of accidentally trained for a marathon.
It was longer distance, that's right. She said, you could almost do a half marathon. So
wow.
Yeah. So that was 2016. It was a mara. No, it was deep into a mara. That's right. Because I'd already done a half. I'd already done the half at Cadbury. That's right. So I'd done a really long run and I did the half at Cadbury and then I did the Bridge Run and that was when I pushed myself because I figured, you know, I'd done the half, so 10Ks, you know.
Mm-hmm.
That's why, this now I know the journey. That's right. Yeah, so she sowed the seed. So started thinking about that and ended up entering Cadbury for my first marathon. First event of the year was a marathon.
2017 then.
2017.
Yeah.
And ran it in 3:54.
Oh my gosh, that's awesome! How did you feel?
Like, stuffed.
Apart from the physical feeling, how did you feel emotionally?
Oh, amazing! It was I'll never forget that feeling because I just ran a marathon. Like all of a sudden, you know, you're in that club. Yeah. Not everybody runs 42Ks, so it's a pretty special feeling.
Although I have to say, and I don't want to burst your bubble, but once I once I ran a marathon, I suddenly realized that people were running even further, like a lot of them. because your group of friends become people who run marathons or ultras, you know, it's a weird thing, and it's suddenly normal.
Yeah, totally.
But I know we are it's not rarefied air, but or maybe it is. I don't know if you were to take the general population rather than, because you surround yourself by people who are like-minded as a rule. And so you end up thinking running a marathon's normal. I know when I first told my dad I was running a marathon, when I ran the first one, you know, we had a dinner, just a family dinner, a few weeks before I was heading to Melbourne. Melbourne was my first one. And he actually was crying. He said, "You'll be the first person in my family who's ever done anything like that." I don't know if that's actually true, but you know, his emotion at that time was like, mm-hmm. "This is awesome." Like, he's a golfer and skier and I don't know, he's a cricketer. He always has been a sporty person, but he'd never attempted something like that. So, and didn't know anyone in his family who had. So he was pretty chuffed. What about your family? How did they feel?
Oh, they were amazed for me. And it's interesting now, all my siblings have taken up, over the last few years, have taken up running.
Wow.
So that's
because of you in many, impetus has come from.
Yeah. So that's the journey. You know, 2017 was my first marathon and I was pretty happy with that. So.
And you've run some ultras too, you said?
Yeah, well, an ultra now. So that's only another 20Ks. It's not that much. So, I did end up doing Lonnie and somewhere around about then I sat down with Jason Alley, who's my coach, mm-hmm. very well known and coach in Tassie. Mm-hmm. And he lives around the corner and my friend who introduced me, took me under wing. She'd done some stuff with him. So we ended up having a coffee at our local cafe and I said to him, I know it was in July, it was after Lonnie 10. Mm-hmm. She said, I think Andrew wants to have a chat. He's thinking about doing the ultra, bringing on ultra as a solo. Mm-hmm. And I said, I've just, got any hits or tips? And he said, yeah, sure. So he scratched out a plan on a napkin.
Oh, wow, that's awesome.
He said, follow that. So
you did.
That's what I did. It was really funny because the point to pinnacle that year was a taper run. And it was my best point to pinnacle ever.
No way.
Yeah, that was that year that was really hot. Everyone was falling over on the way up.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, so that was a taper run. It was equivalent to about 30Ks, I think. So by then I'd been out to 50Ks and I was coming down.
Oh, that's amazing.
Yeah, I did Brenny on Ultra. And the story behind that's quite, I'll tell you the story behind that. It's pretty amazing. So my wife, who is over these years, mm-hmm. you know, she had a neck fusion in 2014 mm-hmm. by Andrew Hun. Mm-hmm. 2015, she was diagnosed with incestuous cystitis. 2016, she was diagnosed with autonomic neuropathy, which is her main issue. So she's on medication to support her blood pressure. So when she stands up, it collapses. This is from the neck nerve injury.
Yeah, yeah.
And then she was diagnosed with Crohn's and also migraine disease as well as PTSD. So in this time, running's been my saviour in the sense of, you know, I needed an escape for me to go running. So Sunday long runs became my thing.
Yeah.
I could just chill out, just run for 2 or 3 hours, whatever the case might be, mm-hmm. to keep myself on the straight narrow, otherwise I'd be a mess. So
I love that. It's really powerful, actually, that statement in itself, that just being able to get out and just be with yourself, with the environment, just with your body, in being in the moment, and just get away from all the pressures of your everyday life.
So that's otherwise I'd be taking medication or something like that. Mm-hmm. I knew that I needed to find an outlet that was just for me. Mm-hmm. And that's not being selfish. It's just if I can't function, our whole family stops.
Exactly.
I'm the only one that generates income for our family. So the only one that does, I just can't afford to be. And the other thing was for health, health and wellness. Mm-hmm. I needed all the tools in my toolbox to make sure that I'm as healthy as I can be. So this, you can see how this whole journey is coming together.
So
I did the ultra, but my son, who happened to be on a 6-month sabbatical from uni because he decided to change degrees, was at home. And I asked him whether he'd be my support driver. And because you have to have a support person. So the day before, Susie was unreal and we ended up having to put her in a hospital. So I thought, man, this is going to throw my whole plan out because we're going to go down to Bruni, stay there on, stay at Bruni on the Friday night, as everyone else does. So you can start at 5 or 6 in the morning. And couldn't do that. And I said to Susie, look, what do I do? She said, look, I'm going to be in hospital. Best place for me. I can't do anything. You can't do anything. Go and do the run. You've trained for it. You've spent 4 months training for it. So I said to my son, be at my house, stay overnight, and we'll do a Bruni run, a Bruni first ferry run.
Wow.
First thing Saturday morning. And so we got a really early, drove down to the catch to be in the queue to catch the first ferry. Got over on the first ferry, thankfully. And then, oh my God, you can't drive around the normal road. You have to go around all the back roads. No, I didn't know that. It took 40 minutes to get to the start line.
Wow.
So I finally got there and went to the registration thing. She goes, I said, oh, yeah, Andrew Woodford, blah, blah, I'm doing the solo. She said, they've all left. I said, oh, no. She said, I'll get you in the next wave. You've got until 2:30. You know, that's when the cutoff was. So wow. I went, oh, my God. So this is 8:15.
Oh, my gosh.
So they put me in the next wave and off I went. And I went out way too hard first. I said to my son, meet me at 20Ks and, you know, for refueling or whatever. But I went, I was running 5:30s for the first 15Ks. Yeah. So I'm down those dirt roads.
Up down that hill, out of the...
Stupid person. So, you know, he met me, he's waiting for me 20. I said, no, I'm all good. Meet me 30, which is on the neck halfway through. So I ran the next 10, got passed by Dave Thomas and Miriam, because they were in a fast team, and I'm going, oh, my God, these guys are sprinting. How are they doing this? Like, it's just literally rocketed past me. I was so impressed.
Yeah.
You know, I'm going down the neck, trotting along, doing, you know, my plan was to stick at six-minute K, which is pretty slow. But anyway, I was doing 5:30s, 5:35s, I suppose. So I met my son, got a heap of water, got some more gels and all that sort of stuff. Pouring with rain. That was a year of rain the whole time, soaked to the skin. And then took off, and that's when the hills start. Nobody told me how hill it was.
Really hilly in that second half.
So it became a bit of a struggle, and because I went out too fast, and you know, I was dropping back and walking some of the hills and running down the others, and then all these people are going back, and they'd all finished.
And I
didn't tell anybody either. I did the event, I didn't tell anybody. I sent some of the guys in the gym going, "It's Andrew." They're waving at the windscreen. So
that was a nice surprise.
Yeah, so it was a nice surprise. So anyway, I got down there and I stopped at the gate. Didn't know you had to, because no one around. Didn't know you had to go to the bloody top of the steps. So I found out they had to go to the lighthouse. So yeah, I got down there. I think it was 6 minutes, 6.5 hours, but I actually did finish. I think it was the finish time was 6 hours, 50 something, because I didn't know I had to go to the bloody top of the steps.
No.
So you got up the steps, got the obligatory photo with the sign, and yeah, so
so you did it.
So I did it. Yeah, I'd tell you what, the last 10 was really hard, and I didn't want to quit, but I knew that I knew I had to do it. So you know, I did it, and so I got back to the car and I said to my son, I am never doing this again, which is now wrong because
I was going to say, have you done it again?
No, I haven't done it, but I'm keen to.
You are.
And my legs were so sore. And then he drove like a bloody rally driver back to the bloody to the ferry, and then we pulled into Margate Banjos, and oh man, I hoofed some food, I can tell you.
Oh my gosh. So you didn't even go around to, is it a Lona to the?
No, I need to get back to the hospital. So I went.
Yeah, of course.
We pulled in there and had a real coffee and lots of food, and went straight to the hospital. And the interesting thing, what actually happened though, from that inspired my son.
Oh.
He took a photo in the post-its and just one of the best posts I've ever seen, which made me tear up, I suppose. And then he kept a photo of that in his uni room.
Wow.
So I don't know for what reason, I never asked him, but he said, no, I've got a photo of that photo, you come up the hill, Dad. So whether that's inspired him for he's studying, or he's now taking up really, he's got really serious running the last couple of months. So, yeah.
Isn't that amazing? I love that. Like, it's one of the things we talk about on the podcast, actually, like especially to parents and actually to people whose parents were running, but just that effect it has on children, on your children, even if they don't necessarily run at the time that you do or whatever. It means it's in their toolbox. Like their toolbox of life. Later on, they'll know, well, you know, mum, dad used to run or does run, and so therefore, they're, you know, their DNA is in my DNA. I can run later if I need to as well, or whatever, you know, not just to catch a bus, but if I, you know, suddenly decide I need to get healthier or I want to get healthier. So I love that.
Yeah, well, I think that's he runs now, and I've done a few 5Ks with my daughter, and she both my daughters are hypermobile because Susie's hypermobile and they're dancers. But it's helped her with her. She does a lot of high energy dancing, so hip hop and stuff like that. So it's actually helped with her cardio.
Oh, of course.
But she's not doing a lot of running at the moment. But I wonder whether down the track it will.
Yeah. Oh, I'm sure it will. So, what goals do you have at the moment with your running?
I've got a long-standing goal, and that's to break 40 for 10.
That used to be one of my goals. I never got there, and I feel like I'm too old now.
I kind of think that I can still do it, but I'm not now because I haven't done a heap this year. But my fastest is 43, so still got to find 3 minutes, which is, as we know, a light years in running. So.
Well, I got to 45, but, yeah, I think I'm a slow runner. I just like running slow now. And I want to hit the trails more.
I could do it. I could get into that. Actually, I could really get into trail running because you don't have that pressure of, time. Exactly. So, I just enjoy the running. I've tend to do it. I've got some long-term ambition goals of doing the Abbott series.
What's the Abbott series?
That's the 6 majors around the world.
Oh, yeah. Wow.
You know, it's a bit of a, you know, so that's New York, Boston, Tokyo, Paris, London, and Berlin.
Yeah. Perfect. What a great goal. I love that. I love running tourism as well. Like that. Go to a place and explore it either, you know, with running and going to an event and being part of it. And it's all really pretty cool.
It's all stopped for the last couple of years, so you don't see much about it. But
stopped a little bit.
Yeah. You know, this little bug turned the world upside down. And
it absolutely did. So you had this little bug earlier in the year, you were saying before we got on?
Oh, only last COVID. In the last couple of months, yeah.
So recently.
Recently, yeah. So I as I just said to you at the start.
Yeah.
My last run was around the 41 track in Melbourne a month ago.
I'm sure there'll be people who'll be really keen. Like, I've obviously been around the very outside of that during the Melbourne Marathon a few times, but not actually, what, you know, you explain what you told me about the run that you got to do there.
Well, I wanted to run exactly around the track. So because the main straight where the grandstand isn't actually, or it's part of it, it becomes an normal road, it's like a car park. Mm-hmm. Most people don't run around that. So I went around that and they were dismantling because the 41 had been on the weekend before.
Yeah.
And so I came to the main straight and there's cranes everywhere and the guy with one of the stop signs, and he said, "Oh, hang on a sec." He said, "What are you doing?" So I just wanted, I'm trying to do exactly where I lap. He said, "Oh, hang on a sec. I'll stop the traffic and you can run down the straight." So that was pretty cool. So I ran all the way down the straight and around the next corner, around the next bend.
Did you feel like you have to run like really fast?
Oh, did actually. I didn't want to hold the traffic up. So I sort of did a bit of a pacey straight run. And
that's hilarious.
Yeah, it's quite funny, really.
So you're also then you got COVID, and that's kind of slowed you down a little bit because we have to be very careful when we're coming out of COVID.
Absolutely, and I mean, to me, it was just a head cold, but the cough was pretty nasty, and it hung on for a bit. And I found that the cold air tend to make it a little bit worse. So my coach said to me, "Don't get long COVID, just walk." Yeah. Mm-hmm. So
good advice.
Fine. I'll listen to him, and because I don't want to get that, and I can't afford to be get sick full stop. So so I've had a month break, which has actually been really good. I've just started to get out there about and go for a bit of a run. So I'm actually looking forward to it. I'm actually hanging for a run.
Everybody's running when you can't run, that's what I noticed. It's a bit like when you suddenly want a particular type of car, which will appeal to you. You see it everywhere. Like suddenly there's like whatever that model is, it's everywhere. It's like, what? When you can't run, everybody's running.
Yeah. Yeah, I can see them, you know, running along because I live just on the river. Yeah. And they run past.
It's like they're doing it on purpose. Stop it.
Yeah, stop. Go around me.
That's right. So, okay, when you, in your normal running sort of time, how do you motivate yourself to get out? Like, obviously, you've now run a number of runs which have required a running plan. So you know that you need to go out and do X, Y, Z, whatever the coach has set, whatever's in your plan. How do you do it on those days when you really don't want to go for different reasons? How do you get yourself motivated?
I just do it, I guess. That comes from, as you said, I don't need to do much with you because I'm pretty well self-motivated. But I guess that just comes from discipline, which, you know, the Air Force ingrained in me for a whole life. Some things I look at and go, because I live next to me is a street that's got a hill on it. That's what I do with hill sprints. But it's actually too steep for doing hill sprints, but I do them anyway. and I sort of go, oh, this is going to be not fun, you know. But I've learned the first few I nearly vomited because I was going too hard. And I posted on Strava, and one of the followers on Strava said, oh, my God, I was coming down the hill. You were going so fast. So I've learned to, you know, not go stupid. You know, I've learned to do them at a pace that's challenging enough, but not to the point where you're going to throw up because it's done.
Because there's two things there that it makes me think of. Not enough people are comfortable with being uncomfortable, and I'm sure the forces helped you get over that and realize that being uncomfortable, especially for a goal, for an end thing, is actually a good thing, and being comfortable all the time is not good. But also there's that element of, if we don't enjoy some part of what we're doing, it's very hard to keep doing it. So there's obviously something even in all those hill sprints that you get a little bit of something at some point that you're able to focus on and say, you know, whether it is, I just really like the satisfaction that I feel when I finished my hill sprints or whatever.
Yeah, it's the satisfaction of moving and completed something and done it. Let's face it, we get our feel-good endorphins. So I understand enough now about the human body and the chemical release from doing exercise. I mean, that's, you know, we all talk about the runner's high.
Yeah.
You know, you just feel, you know, I do everything in the morning because I just haven't got time at night. So I get up pretty early and do stuff in the morning. Yeah. It's just sets you up for the day. Mindset's great. You know, your focus, clarity, you know, it's just, and you just feel good. You know, if really, you've got some, you know, feel good endorphins flying around the body. So
to start the day.
Yeah, just that's what I, you know, I get. I love that. I love that feeling. I love the feeling of, you know, I've just done that. I've just done a Mona run I don't like doing 2K intervals much. You know, I struggle with those. You know, that's what you're going to be doing. I've got, you know, all around me now in my local area, I've got, you know, I know that's 1K to there. So I know if I do two of those and then do a 90-second break, then do another two and then, you know, do three sets of 2K intervals sort of thing. I enjoy long runs though.
Yeah, so do I. In the sprinting, I was just thinking, what do I enjoy about the sprinting? I was a sprinter at school, so I used to enjoy that. So I've got that memory, like that muscle memory in the back of my brain. But when I start do sprint work, which I don't do enough of, by the way, it's the first bit. I really like that initial bit before the lactic acid and everything kicks in. I really love that feeling of moving fast. Yeah. When you, the no pain part, it's kind of like, it might only be like, I don't know, 10 meters, but I love that initial bit. And so like you were saying, the 2Ks, when you're trying to maintain that kind of thing, that's that does actually hurt quite a bit.
It does, yeah.
As I said, I don't do enough of that. Do you are you still going to the gym and doing strength work as well?
I stopped going. Well, COVID fixed up that gym, unfortunately. But I have two people that left over from that gym that do PT now. Okay. So up until a few months ago, I've just continued on doing just PT.
Okay, so you've done strength. You do strength work as part of your plan as well.
Yeah, just strength work. Yeah,
That's again very important.
Yeah, it's just strength work, sled work. You know, weights. But I do stuff at home now. So
So how often in a week are you doing something? You know, when you're not getting over COVID.
I would do. Well, my normal plan was I'd run four times a week. I sometimes would do extra things. I'd throw in extra things. I have a little Saturday morning thing where I'm just like, I just go and do 5K. It's not a park run because it's too late for me. But,
yeah.
You know, I go and do a park run and get a coffee. And
yeah.
I've got this 5K circuit, which I just do is I just, you know, it's on the beach.
Yeah.
It's great, you know. You know, I follow up with a Sunday long run. Monday's usually a rest. Tuesday I might do some intervals or sprint work. Wednesday is strength. Mm-hmm. Thursday could be sort of like 8Ks. Friday's a rest.
Yeah.
So, but okay. I've thrown in the bike this year. I've got on the bike this year. So
oh, first again. Time wow. Yeah. That'd be great for
you. The bike out. The bike I had for 10 years and hardly ridden. So,
do you know how much the bike technology has changed in 10 years?
A lot.
I was just thinking it's probably heavier than most of the bikes.
It's pretty. It's actually aluminium frame. It's very light. My wife bought it for me from off one of her friends' husbands who was back then he was into the best of everything, so it would have been it was top of the range back then. So it's pretty light, but I've really enjoyed that too. Wanted to do less impact but keep the cardio up. So, and it actually, Jason was saying how much it actually helps running, which is true because your cadence becomes very set because of you know you're cycling. Mm. And you're keeping that cadence. Both legs are doing the same thing. So, so for running, it helps to keep your cadence pretty well spot on. So whether it's fast cadence or slow, but it's very consistent.
Interesting. I should get my bike out. Do you run with people much? Like I know you've talked about a couple of people.
Not often. Mm-hmm. Not often. Occasionally. I've got a few people. That, yeah, because I do it so early. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but occasionally, yeah. I like to go and run with some people. Be good.
Yeah, I imagine. And mostly you like to run on the road, or that's sort of how it's been at the moment, or do you mix it up with trails as well now?
No, I mix it up with trails in the beach.
Mm-hmm. In the sand, the soft sand.
Trying to do the hard sand. Sometimes I go down to Sidmore Beach, which is, you know, if you measure it, it's 9Ks from one end to the other, so you do 18Ks.
Yeah, oh, that's all right. That's not too bad at all.
Boring is batshit because it's just
beach,
and it's just a straight curve.
Yeah, and you can see the whole thing.
Yeah. That's always. I think it's 9Ks from one end to the other, but it is. So.
That's crazy. Beach is a part of the Convicts and Wenches Beach beaches. There's lots of beaches, but one of the beaches is along to Baker's Beach, and it's 7K in one direction, then you turn around and come back. So it's 14K.
Just that's a good one.
The same beach.
It's like, right.
And that's like in the middle of their 52K. So it's like, whoa. Oh, anyway, so you have to come up and do that at some point. Do you listen to stuff when you're running, or are you just with your thoughts?
A few years ago, yes, I was running with, I listened to mainly either podcasts or personal development.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Great time to be, you can chew through some books, long runs.
You can.
But of the last probably 18 months, I've just run with nothing, listen to my breathing, getting the smells, listen to the nature. I find the running on the beach is quite, cathartic in the sense that listen to the waves and I find that really relaxing. So
that kind of being in the moment. There is a name for the kind of sounds that we have in nature, like rain and waves and things like that. You can Google it and go on YouTube, and people use it to go to sleep. Kind of sounds. I'm trying to think what it's called. There's a term for those sort of sounds. And people use it to, for calming and relaxing and going to sleep and things like that. So luckily you don't fall over when you're out there running on the beach. A nice, relaxing sort of time. What kind of things are you thinking about in those times? Like without going into detail, but.
I guess I'm learning to be, I find that we've had some challenging times as a family in the last 3 years. So I find that I reflect on what I've learned, being super grateful for the opportunities I have, grateful for my health, grateful for family. I find that that's where I think about it. I get awesome ideas as well. Yeah. I find it's a great place to solve challenges that may have. Uh-huh. So, yeah, but probably mainly just being grateful and having that ability to, you know, just tune out, and it's great for my mental health. Yeah,
I guess being that's
big one.
You'll be back to it soon. Just being grateful that just that we can move and still move our bodies as they're intended. I think there's something about that. Like, we're made to move. In that, running is quite a natural movement, even though some people don't feel like it is, depending on what you're doing. It actually is quite a natural movement for our bodies.
Well, I think also the freedom. You know, we have the freedom just to pull out a pair of runners and go for a run. So, I mean, how fortunate and lucky we are, as you say, we can just go for a run. You know, it's awesome how we can just go do that.
That is amazing. So, in saying that, what do you think running's given your life that you wouldn't have if you hadn't gone to the gym and started running?
I would hate to think if I was continuing down that other road, I'd probably be a very unhealthy 56-year-old. Probably have medication for some heart issues, no doubt. I'd be have some sort of disease, maybe. I don't know. I just know that the continuing pressures on us, on me and on our family, and my extended family as well, with some of the challenges we've had there, you know, I guess I wouldn't like to be where that road would have gone.
Yeah.
And I certainly wouldn't have the resilience that I've got now after the last three or so years. So, it's given me, you know, much, much better focus, clarity. I know what I need to do, but also resilience.
And I love the way you put that. And I guess strength too. Which is all rolled into strength to take on whatever life throws at you, which is what resilience is all about.
Exactly right.
So in saying all of that, how long do you think that you will run for?
I plan on running until I can't. And it's interesting, I saw a photo the other day, I think it was on Facebook, there was a guy in a run somewhere, he was 86 years old, and he did some phenomenal time for the event. I was staggered, and I thought, if I could be that good at that age, I'd be impressed.
I think we might have touched on it earlier, but what motivates you? What goals get you running? Like, are you driven because they're to go faster? Are you driven because there's an event coming up? Are you driven because of how it makes you feel? Or is it a combination of a whole bunch of things, do you think?
If there's an event coming up, I guess it's wanting to get the best out of myself. I just want to continually improve as a person.
Yeah.
You know, the only person that you should be competing with is yourself. So to become better at running for myself, you know, that's from an event point of view. You know, we all know we've got a time to try and beat. And look, as we know, events on the day, they have their own way of coming out. Some days you're in the zone and it works, and some days you think, well, that sucked. How did that go fall apart? Like, that wasn't meant to happen. That wasn't the plan. And as we know, that's what runs do. And I think marathons, everybody that's run a marathon knows every marathon is different.
Yeah.
So that's quite, you know, it's interesting to see when you do an event like a marathon, how that it works out. You know, you just don't know how that event's going to go. So also for mental health and also for health. Mm. You know, it's just, I'm motivated because I just know the satisfaction and the feeling I get after a run.
Yeah. You want to keep it in your life as long as possible, if not just forever. If not just forever.
Absolutely. As long as the body handles it. So, I mean, it's impact. So you've got to be really aware of that. I've taken 7 or 8 kilos off in the last few months. So that's on the lightest I've been in more than 35 years.
Wow. That's amazing. Well done. Is there anything about running that we haven't touched on that you wanted to share?
give it a go.
Yeah.
It's simple. It's just a pair of runners. Oh, I will tell one thing. Make sure you go and get fitted correctly for running shoes by professionals. I think that's a really common question I've seen a lot of the running groups, people post, what are the best runners to buy? You know, and we all know that after you've done it for a while, if you don't go to somewhere like, what's the shop up in Launceston?
Running company.
Yeah, the running company, and the same thing down here with Runner's Edge.
Yeah.
You know, they're amazing. The staff are trained well. They know what you're going to pick before you do, which I thought was hilarious. You gave me three choices, three brands. You know, I got one I got fully correctly. So I strongly encourage people, if they're going to get serious, that they go and get fitted properly so you don't get any injuries. Because at the end of the day, we don't really want to have any injuries. So I'm fortunate. No. I haven't had many injuries. I've rolled my ankle twice. That's very good.
Touching wood for you. There you go. No injuries. Thank you. Thank you so much for all the time that you've spent with us tonight. It's been amazing. But before you go, do you have any tips, especially for beginner runners? Obviously the shoes bit, but anything else that you would share with someone if they came to you and said, Andrew, I'd really like to start running. What would you
say? I would suggest that they start, like everything else, really small. Mm-hmm. Just run a K. Yeah. I think park runs are great. If you want to start running, what a great place to go, because you've got that community, you've got all that spirit. As we know, the running culture or the running community is all about support and encouragement. There's no judgment. I think that's an absolutely fabulous thing. I just love being part of organisations where there's just no judgment. Everyone knows where everyone else is at, and everyone's so supportive. So
isn't that awesome?
You can go and do a park run, but only run the first K, then walk the rest, and then next time, you know, run the half K's, or, you know, run if you're going running just by yourself. Run to one traffic light, walk the next traffic light, run the next power poles.
Yeah.
You know, that's a great way of building up some experience and distance, you know, and starting really small. So, you just can't go and run 5Ks the first time if you haven't done it before. You just won't be able to walk the next day. So.
And we want you to keep coming back. It's a consistency thing, isn't it? It's not like.
Yeah. Some people are a bit overly ambitious and then wonder why they can't walk. So
that's so true.
I mean, if your body's not conditioned to it, then it's not going to be able to cope. So
do it slowly. I just thought of something then when you were talking. The people that you work with, this family business, have known you for a long time, like almost 30 years or something. They've known you post, pre-running and post-running. What do they say about your running?
They've been really supportive. So the owner's, you know, I see him on the beach quite regularly, so I'll stop and have a little chat to him, and you know, he goes, I wish I was, you know, 30 years younger, I'd be able to, you know, do it with you, sort of thing. And I think there's a little bit of, not envy, but, you know, he's been really positive, really supportive, and you know, most of the other guys don't say much, but I look at it and think, heart attack won't happen, heart attack won't happen. I'm not like that, but they're all, the older ones are all carrying weight.
Yeah,
late 40s, early 50s. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I'm not.
Yeah, and that's a good choice that you've made, I would say.
Well, that's it. Life is all about choices. So I chose to, for the reasons I've shared, is to be as healthy as I can.
Yeah, and it's not just
that's the primary reason. The
whole family.
Yeah. Primary reason. Yeah,
I love it. All right, Andrew, again, thank you for sharing your inspirational story. It has been a delight to learn more about you. Do stay on after I say goodbye on the here. But again, thank you for sharing your time. I do appreciate it.
Oh, I'm overwhelmed. Thank you so much for having me. I really, really enjoy the chat. And I hope, you know, my story inspires other people to pick up some runners and go and have a run.
I'm sure it will. Absolutely positive. Thank you.
Thanks so much.
Thank you for listening to the Fit Mind, Fit Body podcast. I'd love to talk to you about your running journey. So send me a message on Facebook or on the website and let's do it. For a bunch of resources on mindful running that will help you get and stay mentally and physically fit, head over to the website, fitmindfitbody.co, and I'll see you there. Plus, I'll be back here in your podcast player a few times a week. Hit subscribe now so that you don't miss an episode. And before you go, I'd really appreciate it if you'd leave a review. It'll help more people to find the podcast and get inspired to start running. I'll see you soon. Bye.